Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, depending on where you are. My name is Maury Piper. I'm the Dean of the School of Business here at George Mason University in suburban Virginia. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you to our Business for a Better World speaker series featuring Kerry Kennedy. Business, as we know, extends well beyond creating short-term value for shareholders and for even for wider stakeholders. It's a long-term game. And we at the Business for a Better World Center here at Mason believe that business can and should be a force for good in society. And that's why we chartered the center a couple of years ago. If we're gonna get there, it's gonna include reorienting business education, not just business practice. And our center demonstrates the critical role that business can and should play in addressing the world's critical problems by providing these hands-on, thought-provoking and distinctive learning experiences, including this series. We engage leaders, we shape business education, and we try our best to prepare tomorrow's leaders to act with people, planet, and prosperity all in mind. We're in the habit of bringing leaders to campus, although in the past year, we've brought them more virtually than physically, which is fine. To our students in particular, we're trying to bring leaders and connect them. This is central to our mission of developing leaders for the future. The Business for a Better World speaker series, therefore, is a chance to bring real social impact and those who have driven and created it together with thought leaders from top tier organizations to our students directly, where they can discuss issues facing the world. And of course, we are joined by faculty, by staff, by alumni and friends from around the region and the world. It's my pleasure and my honor indeed to introduce our guest today, who is Kerry Kennedy, president of Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights. RFK Human Rights has advocated for a more just and peaceful world since 1968, working alongside local activists, ensuring lasting and positive change in governments, in corporations, and the way that the world functions. This is an organization that works both in the US and around the world, pursuing strategic litigation on key human rights issues, educating millions of students in human rights advocacy, fostering a social good approach to business and to investment. Kerry Kennedy is the seventh of the 11 children of Ethel and Robert Kennedy. She's a world-renowned human rights activist who works on a range of issues, including child labor, women's rights, disappearances, indigenous land rights, judicial independence, freedom of expression, ethnic violence, reform of criminal justice, immigration, impunity, and environmental justice. She's a lawyer and author, as well as a human rights advocate, and she's devoted more than 40 years to the pursuit of equal justice, the promotion and protection of basic rights, and the preservation of the rule of law. She's the author of New York Times bestseller, Being Catholic Now, as well as Speak Truth to Power and Robert F. Kennedy, Ripples of Hope. It's my honor and pleasure to introduce Kerry to you today. She will speak on some of these issues for maybe half an hour to 45 minutes. We will absolutely take questions through the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And the plan would be to bring them at the end of Kerry's remarks, but if something comes up that she chooses to engage with, meanwhile, we'll take it informally if you would like. And then we're gonna run to about 1:15 or so. So Kerry Kennedy, welcome. Thank you for being with us. It's an honor and a pleasure to have you.
Well, thank you so much, Dean Pepperell, and thank you everybody for tuning in. I know we all have too many of these Zoom calls, and I really appreciate your interest in this very, very important subject. First of all, let me say hello, George Mason. As you heard, I'm Kerry Kennedy, and I'm the president of Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights. This is not my office, it's my bedroom. So welcome to my home. I'm talking to you today. I'm doing something that many of you also probably have made a practice in your classes and your meetings. I might look dressed up from the waist up, but from the waist down, I'm wearing my leggings, as you can see. And that may all change soon. News outlets around the world have reported in recent weeks that fashion is finally looking beyond the pandemic. fall 2021 collections shown in New York and Milan and Paris are all showing designs centered around a return to society. That means pajama separates, sweats, hoodies, and yes, leggings may fade in popularity. What I'm hoping will not is a more heightened focus on treating those who make our clothes with dignity. And that's what I really want to talk about today. This pandemic period has been marked by massive societal reckonings, and we would be remiss to simply eagerly anticipate and appreciate new runway looks without calling for changes in the $2.4 billion fashion industry that for decades has been a vortex of sexual harassment, racism, discrimination, forced overtime, substandard wages, denied maternity leave, and unsafe working conditions. With women accounting for 80% of the garment sector workforce, the International Labor Organization has warned that many of the impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic will disproportionately impact women and be exacerbated due to these long underlying factors. 25 years ago, talk show host Kathy Lee Gifford broke down in tears on national television. A labor activist had testified in Congress that the most popular television star in our country was reaping millions on the sweat of 13 and 14-year-olds in Honduras who were working 20 hours a day for less than $22 a week, sewing clothes with her name on them. The demand for turning out Kathy Lee pants was so high that worker Wendy Diaz said, quote, "Sometimes they kept us working all night long until 6:30 in the morning," unquote. Her plea to be excused to attend high school was refused. The girls, mostly in their mid-teens, suffered repeated sexual harassment. Diaz said workers were told they would be fired instantly if they tried to organize, and that she expected to be blacklisted for coming to the United States to speak out. Then it got worse. Several days later, women who were producing Kathy Lee garments in sweatshops in New York City claimed they had not been paid at all. Her late husband, Frank Gifford, went to the factory and started handing out $100 bills to bewildered seamstresses. When confronted, Kathy Lee pleaded innocence. All she had done was license her name. Walmart took immediate action and announced it was closing all the factories in Honduras. Then Gifford was labeled a pariah for stripping the poor women who depended on the work as their only means of income. Nobody came out well. The women, the seamstresses, lost their jobs. Kathy Lee was hated. Walmart's reputation for creating profits on a sweatshop model was sealed for nearly three decades. That was the start of corporate social responsibility in the apparel industry as we know it today. Over the last 25 years, much has been learned about human rights violations in the apparel industry and what is effective in creating change. The first lesson of the Kathy Lee episode is name and shame is not the most effective way to create long-term change in the apparel industry. While those tactics have a place, they are just one tool in our toolbox, and the far more effective way to create sustainable change is for all the sectors in the industry to work together at a common table. The sewers, inspectors, unions, human rights defenders, retailers, national governments responsible for protecting worker rights, and the international organizations. It turned out that Kathy Lee licensed her name to Kelwood. Kelwood had a division called Halmode. Halmode had a contract with Walmart, which said all apparel must be manufactured in New York City, but can be subcontracted when necessary to a company in Alabama. the Alabama company, then subcontracted to the factory in Honduras. The subcontracting happened when, as Kathy Lee explained it, sales tripled Walmart's expectations, and suddenly it was, we need to get 50,000 more blouses out fast. I think that's part about how this came about. Maybe we just grew too fast, unquote. That model of wheel and spoke factories is endemic in the international business today. In 2013, the Rana Plaza building collapsed in Dhaka, Bangladesh, crushing over 1,334 garment workers and maiming or injuring 2,000 more. In response, the apparel industry came together to address worker safety in Bangladesh and committed to invest $280 million to inspect factories and pay for fire safety and other improvements. Despite nearly 3,500 inspections in Bangladesh to date, only a handful of factories have finally passed final inspections. Bangladesh operates, much like Kathy Lee Gifford found out, on a wheel and spoke system of factories. The wheel factories have contracts with international retailers, and under the eye of inspectors, some of whom are competent and others who are barely literate. When retailers have a sudden increase in demand, and the 4,000 or so wheel factories are unable to meet that demand, the wheel factories subcontract to the 3,500 spoke factories or informal factories. Let me quote from the NYU Stern report, Beyond the Tip of the Iceberg. Quote, in a June 2015 survey of two sub-districts of Dhaka, 32% of the 479 factories surveyed were informal subcontractors. 91% of the informal factories produced at least partly for export. Informal factories are a subset of indirect suppliers. They do not register with the government, either of the two national trade associations of apparel manufacturers or foreign brands. Workers in this part of the sector are especially vulnerable because they are so invisible to regulators and their employers operate on such slim margins that they cannot invest in even basic safety equipment or procedures. This kind of subcontracting also artificially depresses prices because it does not account for the full cost of producing in accordance with minimum labor standards. The Bangladesh Accord for Fire and Safety and Building Safety and the Alliance for Bangladesh Worker Safety, two factory safety programs initiated by more than 200 foreign brands, encompass only 27% of factories in Bangladesh. Only 3 million workers are not, almost 3 million workers are not covered by those two programs. Part of the problem is the inspection regime. As a result of the Kathy Lee Gifford disaster, the industry created a multi-million dollar industry of factory inspectors. There is a wide range of capacity and no real standard of excellence. Some auditors are well-trained and report honestly what they see. Others do not know what to look for. Still, others never show up at all. The industry is so unreliable that apparel companies which depend on it are wasting their funds and endangering workers' lives and risking another Rana Plaza. When those girls in Honduras made their plea for help from Kathy Lee, the investment industry yawned. At the time, the largest investors on earth had only one set of questions when it came to investing in companies, and they were all financial. But today, that is no longer the case. For investors, the Rana Plaza disaster was both a question of social values and investment protocols. Investors who had failed to take account of worker safety practices and transparency issues missed what turned out to be a critical element of risk management when they considered risk-adjusted returns. Human rights investing in today's world is not done only because it's the morally right thing to do, although it is, but because human rights violations are real perils that constitute core elements of investment risk management. Human rights shifts our mindset from the quarterly capitalism which dominates decision-making in today's capital markets to a lengthened time horizon. Business leaders know how destructive the pressure can be when they are measured on how much profit they have made in the last 90 days, rather than on how well they are positioning their business to be profitable over the next decade. Sustainable investors take seriously their fiduciary duty of the intergenerational impartiality, which means they have an obligation to give co-equal weight to the effects of corporate actions on current and future investors and generations. The lesson is clear. Investors must look beyond traditional financial algorithms and into the reality on the ground if they are to protect their assets. That's what sustainable investing is all about. People traditionally look at supply chains as going from the CEO to the factory floor, and maybe beyond, to the suppliers of raw materials for the factory itself. But we at RFK Human Rights think of the supply chain going up the chain as well, from the CEO to the investors, and from there to the workers who retire, whose retirement savings are being invested. Sustainability is about corporations or their investors asking themselves, what is the impact of environmental degradation, human rights violations, or corruption on investment outcomes for shareholders? The answer is simple. You might get away with abuse for a few days or months or even years, but if you make an investment and you fail to consider these issues, you are investing in a ticking time bomb. And at some point, that bomb is going to explode. It exploded for Nike in 2001 when they admitted knowingly and actively employing children as young as 10 years old in life-threatening factory conditions in Pakistan and Cambodia. It exploded in Italy with Parmalat, where investors watched as fraud and irresponsible corporate behavior led to Europe's largest ever bankruptcy. It exploded for gun manufacturers across the United States when the teachers' union in Newtown, Connecticut, learned that its pension fund was invested in the same companies that sell the military assault rifles that killed 26 of their six-year-old students and six of their fellow teachers in the December mass school shooting. Cerberus, the owner of the company, announced they were selling their holdings in the gun manufacturer weeks later. As each of these disasters shows us, we can no longer ignore the link between human rights and investment practices. This is especially urgent when we consider that of the 100 largest economies in the world, 70 to 75 of them are no longer countries, they're corporations. As such, corporations are under growing scrutiny. As corporations gain power, they are increasingly being held to the same standards for protecting rights as governments are currently held. On the other hand, more and more investment funds are being directed toward environmental, social, and governance factors in investing to measure both sustainability and societal impact. This is the work in progress for the fashion industry. In 2019, we talked about sustainable fashion, trumpeting garments made from recycled plastic bottles, but rarely mentioned workers' rights. This year, awareness of workers' rights has become inescapable due to global campaigns like the hashtag PayUp campaign, which shame brands into paying overdue bills to factories, and racial reckoning shining light on many racist practices within the industry. Margot Alexandria of Custom Collaborative recently told The Guardian that companies are beginning to consider their workforce in a way they didn't before, questioning what is important and sparking a culture of change. But sparks, as you all know, need air to turn into a movement. True, lasting change is only possible if we all embrace a mindset of sustainable investment. As the International Labor Organization noted in a recent brief, the pandemic has reemphasized the importance of a world of work that supports sustainable economic, social, and environmental development. Ultimately, the COVID-19 pandemic could bring us a step forward in achieving improved standards of work in the fashion industry, including better gender equality in the garment sector. But to do so, it is crucial that governments, businesses, and other stakeholders understand the multidimensional impacts on a largely female workforce and design smart, sustainable, and gender-sensitive recovery policies. For too long, my father, Robert Kennedy, said, we have surrendered community excellence and community values to the mere accumulation of material things. Yet the gross national product does not allow for the health of our children, the quality of their education, or the joy of their play. It does not include the beauty of our poetry or the strength of our marriages, the intelligence of our public debate, or the integrity of our public officials. It measures neither our wit nor our courage, neither our wisdom nor our learning, neither our compassion nor our devotion to our country. It measures everything in short except that which makes life worthwhile. And it tells us everything about America except why we are proud that we are Americans. Sustainable investing is a way to invest in the future that makes life worthwhile, so that we can be proud of the ways in which our money is made, proud that our actions in the marketplace are an expression of our values, and proud to be capitalists, feeling good and looking good from the inside out. Thank you very much.
Wow, there's a lot there. And really, you did that in quite a brief amount of time, but boy, so much to unpack. So let's start. And as I do that, I want to invite the members of our audience here today to go ahead and start putting your questions in the Q&A. I want to invite my colleague Lisa to come back and join us. But so many things, Kerry, coming up here, and if I can be the pragmatic business dean for a moment, I really would love to get from you a sense of what some of these things should look like in practice. And I'm sure you have some examples. But for example, smart recovery plans, as you were describing. Pieces of those, elements of those, GDP. Yes, we know for a fact that it's just not measuring even the whole business scope, let alone some of the things that might arguably be called non-business factors. So, what are good alternatives? What are some good ways to do that? And so many topics here. Rather than ask for a specific example of each one, maybe the best way to start is to ask you, what have you seen by way of solutions in particular industries, companies, countries that you like as potential examples for us to be thinking about?
Well, I think one of the really great examples of success in supply chain issues is the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, which is a group of tomato workers in South Florida. The Coalition of Immokalee Workers was started by a handful of people who had been physically, some of them child laborers without documents, physically abused in the tomato fields in Florida. And they started investigating labor abuse, and they ended up, I think there are a dozen cases of slavery in Florida and South Carolina that they successfully prosecuted. Slavery can exist only in an industry where there is massive abuse across the board. I'll give you an example of one of their slavery cases, and then I'll go back and talk about what their solution is. But in one of the cases, there's a group of about 20 or so people coming up from Latin America promised that they would get a job. They just have to go to this street address in Texas. They all go to that street address. There is a bus there, and they're told, if you get on the bus, we'll give you a job and you'll be able to pay back the coyotes, the people who managed who you have to pay back in order to have come to the U.S. So they all get on the bus. They're taken to a field in Florida. Two of the workers are pistol whipped on the way. And they're brought to a mobile home, and they're told, you're all going to live in this mobile home. This is where you live. And then you walk out of the mobile home and you're in the middle of a tomato field. And then they were all shown how to use binoculars. And so they all looked through binoculars, and they were all told, no, see, with binoculars, you can see what's going on very far away. We have people surrounding you with binoculars, watching your every move. So if you ever try and leave, we will kill you. The mobile home was set up about 20 yards from a Sierra Club center. Wow. Where people went to look at birds with binoculars. So they were surrounded at all times with people, with tons of people changing people with binoculars. And of course, nobody knew. Anyway, they lived there for over a year, and somebody finally managed to get out and stop the abuse. But that's the type of stuff that happens. Now, so how do you end it? What they did is they set up, we've all heard of social responsibility programs. Mostly those are put together by, if you're lucky, the C-suite, but normally by the PR part of the company. So what they did is they set up a workers' code of social responsibility. They brought together all these farm workers, and they said, what's important to you to feel safe in your workplace and to feel dignity in your workplace? And there was a whole litany of things. We need to know that our wages are fair. We need to know that the scale that they weigh the tomatoes on is right. We need to know that there's a place we can go to the bathroom with dignity. We need to have water. We got to have shade. We need to have bathroom breaks. One of the things that they did also that typically, which I witnessed, was just unbelievable, the lack of dignity here. This is only about 5 or 6 years ago. They would tell people, you have to come down to this central square in this town in Immokalee, Florida. You have to get there at 4 a.m. If you don't get there, if you get there after 4, you're going to miss the bus. And then they would choose, you know, the landowners would choose who among the workers that were going to work for them that day. So you'd go out there maybe 3:30 in the morning, hang around to maybe 5:30 and see if you get a job or not. Then let's say you got, you're lucky, you got the job, 4 o'clock, you get on the bus, they bring you 10 minutes and they bring you to a tomato field. Now you have to wait on that tomato field until the dew dries before you can start picking. Wow. That could happen at 10 a.m. And you just sit there and watch the dew dry. So that's the level of the disrespect for people's dignity. Anyway, so they put together this list of everything that they would need. And it included things like a community center and a safe place for their kids to go. And then they took that to the Coalition of Mockley Workers, took that list and went to the buyers, the biggest buyers of tomatoes. So to Whole Foods and to Burger King and to McDonald's and to the biggest brands and said, you've got a problem. There's a lot of slavery in the fields and you don't know whether that's going to explode on you. We can guarantee that we can stop that. But you have to sign up to do this. And you have to pay about a penny more per pound of tomatoes purchased. And they did it. And so now 90% of the tomatoes picked in Florida are within the, are under that agreement for the Coalition of Immokalee Workers. And they have virtually stopped sexual harassment. They've ended slavery. They have ended wage abuse and all sorts of other things. That model is now being used in dairy farms in Vermont, and it's being used in the apparel industry in Bangladesh. So it's growing.
Wow. No, this is fascinating to me. It reminds me a little bit of what we hear about Brazilian rainforest, and that you get a critical mass of bigger firms who may have stand to gain from the destruction of the rainforest, and they come together and say, okay, done. But then you still lose when smaller ones or more local ones or lesser known supply chains don't take those actions. And I am guessing, maybe I'm wrong, I'm guessing it may be easier in the US to make the kind of progress you're talking about than it might be in Central America, or maybe indeed in South Asia. But that's a question. How does this actually vary? There's a question in the chat about Bangladesh and what other places you're active. What are some of the challenges and differences that you see across different places, and to what extent can you get to a critical mass of influencers who can make a difference? Does that look different depending on where in the world you are?
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good question. So the model that I was just describing is incredibly effective. And the thing that I really love about it is that it's worker driven. Mm-hmm. It's bottom up. And they've been very, very, very successful. Incidentally, the holdout is Wendy's. So write a letter to Wendy's, tell Wendy's that what they're doing is wrong, and that would be helpful if you're looking for an action to do after this. And you should also go look at the CIW website, Coalition of Immokalee Workers, and it's very, very good at organizing students, and they always can use more help. So everybody, that's a pitch for the Coalition of Immokalee Workers.
And thank you for that. Let me just make sure we get specific. The problem, the Wendy's issue is around the tomatoes in Florida, or the Wendy's issue is around something else?
It's around the tomatoes.
Okay. Yeah.
So they're one of the holdout firms that buys tons of tomatoes and has not signed on to the fair, it's called the Fair Food Program.
Got it.
and they're refusing to sign on to it. So that's a problem. Now, how do you get companies to pay attention? So we spend many, many, many years at RFK Human Rights going from the bottom up. Like, we would hear that there is an abuse at a factory in Vietnam, and then we would go there, and then we would talk to people, and then we would get local organizers, and then we'd get local journalists, and we'd get an international journalist, and we'd get an article about it in the New York Times, and then the manufacturer would fix that problem. And then the next year they'd be doing the same damn thing in Cambodia. You know, it was just whack-a-mole, not very effective. And then somebody said, well, you should talk to the investors. And what we learned is what everybody in business school knows, but I didn't know this, which is that all those companies are financed mostly by pension funds. So let me just take a moment and talk about pension funds, because I'm sure most people on this call know what that's about, but not everybody will. So when you get a job, you get your paycheck, and out of your paycheck, a couple of things are going to be taken out. So Social Security, taxes, and then if you're in a good place to work, pension money will be taken out. So you pay that, that pension dollars are taken out each week from your paycheck, and they're accumulated, and then you get them back when you turn 65 and retire. More or less, that's the way it works. But all that money is not just sitting in a piggy bank someplace. It all goes to an investor who is now responsible for investing your pension money into corporations and maximizing their risk-adjusted returns, maximizing the returns. So when you turn 65, you get more money so you can retire. That's basically the idea. It used to be that pension funds only thought about maximizing their returns on their investment, and they didn't care what they were investing in. But that ideology is changing. So let me give you an example of why this is so important. The United Auto Workers is the labor union for everybody who works in the auto industry. And the United Auto Workers has a pension fund. So all those rivulets of money from everybody who's working on a factory floor anywhere in Michigan comes into that pension fund, and they invest that to give to the people upon retirement. They have a rule saying that we are going to put a Chinese wall between the investment funds and the union itself. And that's a fine rule to have. And then they had another rule, which is also a good rule, that said, we can only invest in companies that are making a market rate of return. So that's basic. Everybody should do that. That's something you'll learn in business school. Okay, so now it's 2008. And none of the big three auto companies in the United States are making a market rate of return. Surprise. So they're not allowed to invest those funds into any of the big three auto companies. Kia is a South Korean shop that is non-union, and it is making a market rate of return. So the union pension fund invests in Kia.
So that's rich.
Absolutely undermining the interests of the people they're supposed to be protecting. So this type of thing happens all the time, where you see the teachers union investing in gun manufacturers, or you see an environmental nonprofit investing in oil companies because people are not making those connections. One of the big questions that, so one of the things we do at RFK Human Rights is we'll go to a large, let's say, foundation. And for instance, one of the foundations we did this with is a healthcare organization. And so we say, well, how much of your money, of all the money you have, how much of that do you spend on programming, on stopping kids from smoking? They say 95%. We use 5% a year. Well, excuse me. They say we use 5% of our funds per year to do programs, and 95% gets invested. Do you want to hear about our programs? And I was like, no. Your programs are meaningless compared to the 95% you're investing. Where is that money going? Is that enhancing your values? Is it undermining your values? Or is it neutral to your values? And do you even know? And the answer is nobody knows. They have no idea. And they don't know how to get an idea. And so part of our job as a human rights organization is really to work with companies, to work with pension funds, to work with union pension funds, and to make sure that their investments align with their values.
And there is more and more, I would say, even critical mass now in the investment sector, including in the pension funds and the large money managers, around what does it mean to be investing responsibly. I think just in the last probably year and a half, 2 years, you've seen a lot of this. I did want to invite Lisa, if you want to jump in or even take one of the questions from the chat, feel free.
Sure, I'd love to. On this call, we have quite a number of students from George Mason University, and from people on this call who may not be familiar with Mason. We are one of the most diverse schools in the nation, in the top 15, and certainly the most diverse in the state of Virginia. And so one of the students has written a question in here about what are 3 to 5 tangible things that every one of, you know, the young people on this call can do to participate in terms of individual decision making and in terms of action to be supportive of equity and workers' rights?
Okay, I love that question. Thank you so much to that student. So I think number one, educate yourself. Make sure you know what's going on. Read the papers, watch the news, find out what is happening in our country. And that might seem pretty obvious to a lot of you, but you'd be surprised about how many people really just don't, are not paying attention. So I would say start there. Number two, look at your, you guys are in business school, you're going to have a long career. Find out where your pension is invested and have a say in it. Make sure that you can speak up and speak out, and that your investment dollars really are invested consistently with your values. Number three, look at organizations that you admire. RFK Human Rights would love to be part of that list, but it might be others. It might be the ACLU. It might be Amnesty International. It might be the Coalition of Immokalee Workers. Get yourself involved, engaged with at least one, maybe two of those organizations, so that you have you're getting information directly from people on the ground who are working on these issues. And then I think find ways, you know, you're in business school now. You are among the most elite people on this earth. people who have graduated from college and are getting a business degree. You're going to have tremendous influence on our country and on our world in the generation to come. Use that influence. Think about the impact of what you do, not only on your supply chain, but on all of your customers, on all the stakeholders, and on your children and your grandchildren. Think about that, and think about ways that you can start at a very young age feeling comfortable speaking up about those issues in your workplace.
I should probably mention, Kerry, that the demographic at Mason is quite wide, and in fact, the programs as well. So a majority of the students actually in our School of Business are undergraduates, although we have quite a few excellent graduate students as well. And many of the undergraduates and many of the graduates also are working their way through. So I agree with you that we're privileged to be getting the education we're getting. I also just wanted to stress that this is a place where, you know, people tend to be pretty pragmatic. They've had to figure out how to make it in many cases on their own. And that gives our students maybe a greater sense than some business schools of I'll say reality, you know, what mm-hmm. it takes to get things done that they may know even before they come to us. And many of them had to kind of work hard just to get here in the first place. We have also a couple of faculty with us today, and one colleague, Giannis, is asking, in fact, who's about to become our MBA director. Are there organizations, companies that you know of that have been particularly proactive in championing these issues? And you mentioned one or two, but I'm interested if we could maybe get your view on a couple of other examples. And then where does that come from? Is it about a visionary leader, pressures of their market, you know, internal forces, external forces, short term, long term? Why, when this does happen, you know, where do you see it and why?
Well, that's an interesting question. So, there are companies that have been leading the way. So I think that PayPal is one that's been fantastic. Your students are going to know this and better than I do, but there's a wonderful company out in California that was just kind of flying across the Twitter feed this week, where the CEO took a pay cut from $1 million a year to $70,000 a year. Do you know what I'm talking about? Does that sound familiar to you? Okay, that's a great company. I mean, really, just
there amazing. Have been a few. There have been a few that have, yeah.
So that was really interesting. I think that Nike went from very, very bad to much, much better. It's not perfect. It's got a long way to go, but it has improved, you know, tremendously. So I think some of them have changed because of exposure. And some of them, it's really the leadership of the CEO or the board. And then some of them have tried really hard and have made mistakes and stumbled along the way, but are basically working through that. And I would put, for instance, Starbucks into that category.
Interesting. And yes, as we've been, several colleagues have now pointed out, it's Dan Price of Gravity Payments.
Thank you.
Which
I knew somebody online would
yeah, well, that's actually a 5 year now, 5-6 year running story, because he did it 5 or 6 years ago, and it was also about the minimum salary for everyone of 70K. So there's something about how inclusive, how equitable can you be?
Yeah, and PayPal did something very similar too. It's really extraordinary, both in the United States and at call centers across the globe.
all kinds of interesting questions here. Alicia, have you got a favorite one? I'm like, go ahead.
There are so many questions. I'm going to come back to the students because we have so many students in our who are online right now watching this, watching you and saying all sorts of accolades in the Q&A box. One in five of our students reported on a recent survey that they had experienced food insecurity at some point. And we also have students on campus who are really mindful of how the pandemic has affected those students and how it's affected other groups on campus, like our custodial workers, for example. And so some students on campus are advocating for those groups and want to know if you have any advice for how to work within a university or an administration when you're a student, because you've talked about grassroots coalitions and making an effort, but what advice do you have for them?
That's really, first of all, I'm so happy to hear that, that the student body is interested in the university community and in what's going on. So let's just recognize that and recognize that that is not the way it is on a lot of campuses. So great, that's terrific. We actually have a program at Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights, and maybe Lisa or Maury, we could talk about that, bringing that to George Mason in the future. It's called Robert F. Kennedy Young Leaders, and it does exactly this. We go onto campus, we look for people who are marginalized within that campus community. Typically somebody might be a person of color and transgender, so there's, you know, double marginalization. And we give them training on what rights are, what community organizing looks like. We talk to them about an issue that they want to take on the campus, and then we support them in creating change, in building a coalition and creating change on that particular issue. Sometimes it's something that they want to change within the university, and then sometimes it's within the larger community of where the university sits. But if you'd be interested in that, we would love to see if there's a way of bringing that to campus. It's a great program.
Oh, that'd be fabulous. That'd be fabulous.
Okay, great. Something concrete to come out of this.
And if I zoom out for a second to interventions, even structural interventions at a even higher level, there's a question in the chat reflecting some of the news stories in the last few months. What do you think about the potential, the U.S. administration appointing a fashion czar, which of course is not about so much about running businesses as about helping to address some of the issues you've been describing?
Yeah, I think that's important. And I think, especially in the light of the pandemic, and I mentioned this briefly, but the people who are most impacted by this pandemic are women. And the fashion industry is all about women. 80% of the people who sew our garments are women all over the world. And they're the first to get fired. They're the first to have to leave their jobs in order to take care of people who are sick. There's, I think it's 85% of nurses around the world are women. They're the first to be exposed because they're the ones who are taking care of the sick people. And when their wages are lost, their power is lost within the home. So they become much more vulnerable to domestic violence, to losing their homes, to being unable to care for their children, get healthcare, education, so everything else that happens as a result. So to have an administration who is aware about that, cares about it, taking action on it, and appointing somebody to be focused on this, I think is great and a huge change from the last 4 years.
Yeah, indeed. So then staying on the broad picture for a moment, there is a question about the connection between the fight for human rights and the UN Sustainable Development Goals more broadly. I know you've been involved in issues about rights for quite a long time, since before certainly the development of first the Millennium and then the Sustainable Development Goals. What do you think about the process of focusing the world on long-term future goals, as has been this attempt, and educating people around how to look after the future of the planet? Are these things that you've thought about either from a policy point of view or from an education point of view?
Yeah, absolutely. So the just as background, so the countries of the world came together and named a list of goals that would protect the earth and address worldwide poverty. And they said all of us, every country on earth is going to be committed to making change on these issues over the next 5 years. I think it was 10 years. And those are the sustainable development goals. Now, one of those goals is protecting human rights. You can't have real change on economic policy and poverty if you don't have rights, if you don't have a judicial system where people get due process and people have faith in it, where you can't speak openly, where you cannot organize, where rights are not respected. So these are, and the truth is that the Sustainable Development Goals are really based on the articles within the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. If you go through the articles and you go through the SDGs, you'll see that they're completely aligned.
Yeah.
I think that having all the governments be committed to that is extremely important. Having corporations be committed to them has also been extremely important. Having investors in those corporations be committed. This is going to take all of us.
Yeah.
And particularly in the wake of COVID. I think what's been brought home to people the world over is that none of us are safe if anybody is ailing. And that's true for diseases, but it's also true for the disease of lack of education, and it's true for the disease of poverty, and it's true for the disease of domestic violence, and it's true for the disease of femicide. None of these can be done in isolation. We have to work on everything all together, all the time, our whole entire lives.
Yeah, no, I love
that's it. That's what's going to make a difference.
Listening to you kind of lay it out that way, I keep thinking, wow, yes, exactly. And 7 or 8 billion people, and 180 countries, depending how you count. And my God, this is just a massive task. But it's not a task. Sounds like what you're saying. It's a way of life. It's a way of looking at the world and being in the world that helps. And we keep getting a number of comments, questions here around, okay, what does that mean for business? What does that mean for investors? If businesses are about profit, or as my friend Rebecca Henderson, who's written a book on reimagining capitalism for a world on fire, likes to say, it is not about getting rid of profit and capitalism. It's something about making it more balanced, more inclusive, Are we changing the primary purpose of business, I guess, is the underlying question, mm-hmm. and do we need to be investing in a different way, or is it about having standards like some of the investors and pension funds that you were just talking about, or is it changing the system? That's what some of these questions seem to be.
I mean, I'm all for a revolution. I really am. I don't think this thing is working. I don't think it's working for us. I think, look at what's happening with policing. My God, look at what's happening with the number of white supremacists in our military. Look all over the world. Look at the amount of poverty. Look at your student body, that so many people at your great university are struggling just to get by, wondering if they can pay tuition and hold down a job and go to get a business degree all at the same time. Why are we doing that to each other? I mean, let's sit down and reimagine this in a way where people can be treated with respect and dignity and recognize their talent and be able to have loving relationships and do so in a way that is kind and gentle. My gosh, we're, as human beings, you're guaranteed suffering and you're guaranteed love. And we need to build these systems around a lot more around love and kindness and gentleness and understanding than the way they're built now. So yeah, I'm for a revolution.
But there's a lot. That's fabulous. There are also quite a few questions that talk about some of the examples that you've cited with regard to Central and South America. You've talked about South Asia. You've talked about some of the women in the world being harmed or being most profoundly influenced by the pandemic. Can you comment just a little bit about the role of race, ethnicity, gender in sustainability and our ability to progress in that area?
Yeah, well, I mean, here again, look, so the investment industry is a $70 trillion industry. We're at a business program here. So that is completely dependent on investors. Business is dependent on investors. What is the investment industry? $70 trillion. What percentage is controlled by women and underrepresented minority-owned firms? What percentage? Less than 2%. Okay, so none of this is changing. Until we change that, we're not changing the policing in this country until we change the investment industry. We're not changing white supremacy in this country until we change the investment industry. We're not changing any of these things. The amount of violence, the unfairness in our court systems, the disparities of wealth for people getting access to healthcare or a decent education. I laud every single one of your students, but you guys are all the exceptions. You are amazing. You have done this through your will, through your capacity, through your brains, through somehow pulling it together and making it work. But this system is completely aligned against everybody who's on this call. Why are we doing that? Let's make a system that works for you and that works not just for you, but for your brother and your sister and your cousin and your kid and everybody in your neighborhood. That's what we should do.
This is inspiring, and I can't help. I can't help then reflect what another one of our students is asking, which is essentially, okay, what does this look like? You know, how do you do it? Are there particular people that should be leading? Are there particular changes one would have to make in the overall legal or economic structure of society? You know, how do you do that?
The phrase defund the police is a very controversial phrase. Yeah. I like it. And this is why I like it. I like it because if I say to you, we need to change the policing system so it's not so racist and violent, you'll say, that's so great. I believe that too. Now, did you see that show on Netflix last night? I mean, no. It's so easy, of course. If I say to you, no, we're going to defund the police, you go, oh, wait a second. What does that mean? What are you talking about? What? So that's what we need to do here. We need to say we're not going to have a system a generation from now where $70 trillion is basically all controlled by old white men. We're going to change that. And we're going to change it through a series of programs. It's not going to be easy to do that. And that's why you guys are all in school to figure this out. But I would say that the roadmap, there is a roadmap out there. And the roadmap is the Sustainable Development Goals. Because if you really look at the implications for attaining all of those goals, that is the revolution that we're looking for. It's a protected earth. It's an end of poverty. It's an empowerment of women. It is due process. It's everything that I think all of us really want it to be. That's the world we're looking for. All the governments have agreed to it. Many, many huge corporations have said they're for it. So let's use that. Let's use that as the roadmap.
That's great. Lisa, you think we should wrap up about Kerry herself? Because there's a few questions that are sort of.
I was going right. I think that's where you're going on her as a leader, right? Is that where you're headed, Maureen?
Yeah. I mean, there's a couple of aspects to it, right? One is from one of our students, you're such a successful leader. Can you speak about three or four qualities or characteristics that helped you be successful and achieving goals that are consistent with your values? Because as students, we look up to leaders like you. And then another one that said, you know, how do you prevent yourself from burnout, depression, anxiety? If you don't mind talking a little bit about yourself, I'm sure the students would love to hear.
That's so sweet. Okay, so first of all, I'm on a sabbatical for the first time in my life. That's great. I really recommend it. Do not wait 40 years. Take one. So what do I do? I do a lot of things that I think are important for my mental health. I pray a lot. I have really wonderful, wonderful, strong relationships with a lot of people, with my kids, with my family members. Incidentally, I have 10 brothers and sisters, and a pile of cousins and a lot of good friends. And that's really important. I exercise for about an hour a day, about 6 days a week. And I meditate. So those are all really helpful sort of concrete things that I do. But what really keeps me going, and maybe this will be my ending, what really keeps me going is that I see progress. In fact, we've rarely taken on an issue and not made progress on that issue. You know, it might not be historic, but we're pretty effective. We, at any given time, we have 35 cases against governments for human rights abuses, and we've never lost a case. An example would be like when Uganda passed a law that made homosexuality punishable by life in prison without parole. We sued the government, we overturned the law. So we've got cases all the time and we're doing them. We've got great lawyers. We know how the system works and we win. So that gives me hope. And then, you know, my work is working with people who are the Martin Luther Kings and Mahatma Gandhis and Elizabeth Cady Stantons of our time. So they themselves are inspiring, visionary, beautiful, spiritual people. And I get to work with them. So I just feel incredibly blessed. But I'll end by saying this. When I started working in human rights, which was in the early 1980s, all of Latin America was under right-wing military dictatorships. Today, there's not one left standing. All of Eastern Europe was under communism. Today, there's not a communist government left in Eastern Europe. South Africa was at the height of apartheid. Today, South Africa has had a series of freely elected governments elected by a majority of their people. And women's rights was not on the international agenda. And today, CEDAW, which is the Women's Rights Convention, has been ratified by over 185 countries. All those changes came about, not because governments wanted them to, governments tried to stop them, and not because armies wanted them to, great militaries tried to stop them, and not because huge multinational corporations wanted them to. Multinational corporations tried to stop them, everyone. They happened because small groups of determined people harnessed the dream of freedom and made it come true. And you know, Margaret Mead said, no, never doubt the capacity of a small group of determined people to change the world. In fact, it's the only thing that ever has. If you look back at the major changes in our world for good, for human rights over the last 50 years, it's all been small groups of determined people. That's who's meeting on this phone today. That's who's on this Zoom call today. This is a group of people who is saying, I want to make it in this world, and I want to make our world better. And I want to make sure that when I'm doing that, that the people who are picking up the garbage in my classroom are taken care of. I care about them. Those are my cousins. Those are my people. And so let's do this. Let's do it together. We can make the world a better place. So all of us have a role to play. And I look forward to working with you on it.
That's brilliant. So inspiring. And indeed, students on this very call and in the class that Lisa and our colleague Greg Unruh and I are teaching, students are actually working on exactly that issue about the people that are cleaning up after us in this school. Are we treating them, you know, as we would like to be treated? So that's just brilliant. I want to thank you so much for joining us, for the stories, the inspiring words, the ideas. And I hope that we have a chance to connect more with you and with the organization going forward. Lisa, do you want to say anything about what's next in the series or anything like that?
No, I just want to extend, we keep pushing onward and upward, and I just want to extend my thanks to you, Kerry Kennedy, for being with us today and sharing your time and expertise, and as one of our students wrote, your inspiration to this next generation. Thank you.
Oh, very
thank
sweet.
You so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Take care.
And to all that put in questions we didn't get time to, apologies. Do tell your friends we're going to have this recording available. And I hope that it provides the same sort of inspiration for others that it has for us today. All the best.